Welcome, everyone, and good afternoon. Welcome to the Jack Joseph and Morton Mandel School of Applied Social Sciences and the third of our Centennial Research and Training Colloquia for this academic year. I'm Elizabeth Tracy. I'm a professor, and I'm the Associate Dean for Research and Training at the Mandel School. We are a very diverse group gathered here today. We have master's and doctoral level students, alumni, faculty, field instructors, research staff and associates, community practitioners and administrators. We represent the social work and the Mandel School quite well. A warm welcome also to the many viewers connecting remotely through our live streaming. I also want to recognize that Dean Gilmore is here today, over there. Okay. A few logistics. Restrooms are to the right. If you're a student, make sure you sign up for PD hours. If you've signed up for social work CEUs, your certificate will be in the lobby at the end of the session. And some well-deserved thank yous to Helen Menke of the doctoral program, Einar Brand, Maria Sharon, Tracy Braddon from Communications and Marketing, and Nora Hennessy, who's the Associate Dean for Institutional Advancement, for their help with this series. And you'll see Nora during the question and answer time running around with the mic so that we hear everyone's question. This colloquia is co-sponsored by the Office of Research Administration and the doctoral program at the school. And at your seat, you'll find the complete list of colloquia for this year. And we're pleased and proud to note that all the speakers in this series are graduates of the Mandel School. Today, we're happy to have with us Vivian Jackson, who earned her PhD from the Mandel School in 2008, and Toby Morton, who earned both her undergrad degree, master's degree in 1998, and PhD in 2007 from the Mandel School. Each speaker will present for about 50 minutes. There'll be a time at the end of each speaker's talk for questions. And I will direct the questions, but if you could hold your question until Nora gets to you with the microphone, then we will be able to hear everyone's question, and our over 30 remote viewers will also be able to hear. So thank you for that in advance. For those connecting remotely, you can email questions to mandelschool@case.edu during the question and answer times. And at 5 p.m., we started a little bit later, so a little bit after 5 p.m., we invite everyone to the lounge area for a reception and an informal time to interact with the speakers. So let me do a little bit of introduction for each speaker. Our first speaker, Vivian Jackson, will present her work as an assistant professor at the National Center for Cultural Competence, Georgetown University Center for Child and Human Development, and the National Technical Assistance Center for Children's Mental Health, where she provided technical assistance and consultation related to cultural and linguistic competence for the SAMHSA Children's Mental Health Initiative. You might want to know that Dr. Jackson was also instrumental in the development of indicators for the NASW standards for cultural competence in the social work profession that many of us are aware of. She received her MSW from Howard University and her PhD in social welfare from the Mandel School. Her talk today, as you can see up here, is Planning, Implementing, and Evaluating Cultural and Linguistic Competency for Comprehensive Community Mental Health Services for Children and Families. Our second speaker, Toby Martin's presentation, is based on her work as Senior Research Scientist in the Evaluators Institute at the George Washington University in Washington, D.C. Dr. Martin has had extensive expertise in program evaluation using both qualitative and quantitative methodologies. She has worked on SAMHSA-funded projects evaluating the training and the sustainability of the practices and policies being implemented. She received her MSSA and her PhD from the Mandel School. Her talk today is Cultural Considerations in Planning and Implementing Program Evaluations. Please join me now in welcoming our first speaker, Dr. Vivian Jackson.
Good afternoon. It is truly a pleasure to be here and a little nerve-wracking at the same time to be back home in a way to share. I'm almost reminded of my dissertation defense. So when Dr. Tracy called me and she was talking about this resource that she identified from the National Center of Cultural Competence, this long title here, Planning and Implementing Evaluating Cultural and Linguistic Competency, and it was targeted for the Children's Mental Health Initiative, which some of us call the System of Care Grants. And those of you who are local and working in children's mental health may be familiar with Tapestry, with Project Engage now. And there was another one, at least in the southern part of the state at one point. So I think those are the three. There may be others. But for a good chunk of time, and see, when you're old, you don't really say how many years, that was the focus of my work, working with grantees who had received these grants to help them do their work in promoting, advancing, implementing culturally and linguistically competent work. And we'll talk a little bit more about this specific tool, but that's kind of what we did. So what we're going to do today, I'm going to do just a brief overview, and I'm hoping that it is a review for most of you around definitional concepts around cultural and linguistic competence, and some of the things that we have been thinking about exploring, evaluating, trying to understand to do that planning work, to actually do the implementation work, and to do that evaluation work. And I'm looking forward to what Toby will be saying around some of that as well. And we'll have some time for discussion. So to start off with our definitions for cultural and linguistic competence, and I'll focus on cultural competence. This is a definition that came out of the Children's Mental Health Initiative. In the early days, we're talking about the late 1980s, actually. Terry Cross, the social worker, Barbara Bazron, Marisa Isaacs, and others were part of the Minority Affairs Committee for the Child and Adolescent Services Project, or something like that. And they were furious, absolutely furious, that with all the things that we were talking about at the time around the need for children, that there really wasn't good energy around the specific needs of minority children. Now, I'm going to say that because that was the language at the time. And so they did this work that became the seminal work on cultural competence in the field. And you will see elements of this definition sprinkled in SAMHSA language, in HRSA language, in associations. NASW has really picked up on the Terry Cross definition as key, and there are various versions of this definition for cultural competence that was anchored in this work. Some of the key elements to note is that, one, that the issues around policies, practices, behaviors, structures, and attitudes need to work congruently to support an environment to promote effective cross-cultural practice. There are some who will argue about competence. I can't be culturally competent. I don't like the word competence connected with culture. They prefer humility or awareness or sensitivity or whatnot. And our pushback is that what we're talking about is effectiveness. And I think competence and effectiveness do kind of go together. And so we do really kind of focus on this issue around effective cross-cultural practice, and that all these are the pieces that relate to that. The other part about their definition is that they were able to identify certain elements that one would want to see at the individual level, namely, one, that we acknowledge that, in fact, there are cultural differences, that the way we behave and do and our values and our norms are, in fact, different from others, for one reason or another, that we understand our own culture and understand the operations of culture in how we do what we do when we do it, that we see that in our own behavior, the way culture plays itself out for us to help us differentiate what we're imposing and what we're not imposing on someone else, that we engage in the self-assessment process, and this is particularly to pull out those areas of bias and stereotypes and prejudices that we all carry in one way or another, that we do acquire knowledge. And there was a phase in which The notion around cultural competence meant I am an expert in somebody else's culture. Well, no, that is not cultural competence. But you do need to have some knowledge, at least the knowledge enough to know what questions to ask, and some skills in that interface with someone who is different from yourself, and recognize that any and everything that we do is within a cultural context, including what we're doing right now. I mean, the anthropologist would have a field day, right? Watching what we are doing now as a training kind of event because of all the artifacts that are here in the room and the process in which we're engaging it. So we're always being cultural. It never goes away. The other piece that they were talking about is, okay, so if we have to have an organization that is supporting this practice, then what is it that we want to see in that organization? So they were talking about, one, well, the organization itself has to value diversity, and not just cultural or racial diversity, but even consider diversity of thought. That there has to be an openness within the culture of the organization that allows people to have different perspectives and consider that as being okay. That it too needs to undergo a self-assessment process to really kind of get a sense of what's working well and what's not working well. That it has to have a certain skill set in addressing difference, and that's recognizing if we're having people enter a space together, whether it's as provider and recipient or coworker or colleague, who are operating with different cultural perspectives, worldviews, and whatnot, there's going to be some friction. Because it all is not going to work the same across the board, but there needs to be a way of working with that to be creative rather than destructive. And that the organization has the responsibility as a whole to build upon the knowledge around the cultural issues of the service population that they're working with. That it is not sufficient to have, oh, we have a new Hispanic population, so we will hire a few Hispanics and let them take care of all the work. That is not sufficient. That the entire organization needs to develop a certain knowledge and skill about what's important in this particular community, what the resources are, who the key people are. And if not being bilingual themselves, to be able to know how to work with interpreters and how to understand the issues around translation and those things. And the organization needs to be able to adapt to diversity. I recall working with one state mental health department, and we're talking about family involvement, community involvement, and participation. We're recognizing that the families were dealing with jobs in which coming to the office 9 to 5 wasn't going to work for them. And I was just totally amazed at how rigid these workers were about we close at 5 o'clock, period. That there was nothing in their spirit that said, oh, we really have to think through how we organize our own scheduling if we're really going to be serving the community the way we need to. So there are a number of things involved here that go into play. The other thing that we were noting is that this work is not work that is only at the front line. So many times I go into organizations and they talk about building a culturally and linguistically competent workforce. CODE, the clinical staff, is that's what they mean. They're not talking about the receptionist. They're not talking about the security. They're not talking about food service. They're not talking about the accountants. They're not talking about the executives. They're not talking about the board. So when we're talking about the importance around cultural and linguistic competence, we are saying that every party that's involved with the organization itself needs to recognize its role in promoting and advancing cultural and linguistic competence in that system. So that's from those who are at the board level, the governance folks. It means your executive administrative level. It means your frontline folks indeed. But it also means really engaging those who are receiving services in their process between and among themselves, because they bring society in with them too, as well as there being a voice within the operations of the organization, and and bringing in those who are representative stakeholders in the community for this work as well. So ideally, in terms of these last two bullets, we love to see that participation that is members of boards, members of advisory councils, part of interviewing teams, part of service delivery themselves, and part of evaluation teams. When we talk about linguistic competence, we're talking about a similar dynamic in which there are the elements built into the organizational infrastructure that supports that opportunity for language access. Now, when we talk about linguistic competence, the National Center has its own definition that is also being adopted more broadly, in which we're looking at the effective communication for those with limited English proficiency, but also effective communication for those for whom issues around literacy is an issue, issues around disability in terms of communication, who are deaf, hard of hearing, blind, low vision. And we're also tackling the issues around health literacy and mental health literacy because of the bucket that we're working with. We also are saying that, you know, these things really have to be there. And I will highlight the areas around dedicated fiscal resources and dedicated personnel resources as being part of that package that needs to be in place for effective linguistic competence. So, to shift now into the areas around the actual planning process. Big breath. Let's see if I have my little. We'll keep on going. The document that Dr. Tracy was referencing is a document that we often use to help people think through the how. The how, what it is that we want organizations to anticipate, and you know how you plan to plan? Well, this is a planning to plan. This is a planning to plan. So obviously it's important to have a structure. Well, no, it's not so obvious. The early days of the system of care framework, the grants required that the grantees be culturally competent. Now, they had certain expectations in terms of staffing for their grants and certain structures in their grants. There was nothing there about anybody or any entity, any committee, anything that would help promote cultural competence in those grant programs. It was just supposed to happen. I don't know, you breathe the right air and then you're culturally competent. So we're saying, well, no. We really do have to have some type of structure within the organization that takes it upon itself to be the steering process, the facilitators, to think it through and help the organization, and not to be the doers of the work, but to help the organization do its work. And then the organization needs to take the time to really think through its own values, its own philosophy. What does it mean for us as an entity, as an agency, as an organization, as a school, as a university, to be culturally competent? What does that mean for us? What is our definition? What is our vision around what that means for us? And then using that as a guide. We love logic models. We love people to take the time to really think through what that vision looks like, what we got going now, what are the kind of elements that we need, what is our theory of change for our organization, and use that, again, as a framework to help map how we're going to do what we're going to do. Obviously, it's important to be clear about your demographics and the changing demographics. We do expect, if this was a family and youth perspective here, but regardless of your client population, whomever it is that you're serving at whatever level, to get a sense of their satisfaction. And I do a little caveat around satisfaction, because if I'm hungry and you give me white bread and you ask if I'm satisfied, I'll probably say yes. But don't take that to the bank. because if I know that my options are rye, pumpernickel, cornbread, biscuits, and you offer me white bread, I may say no. So much around even our satisfaction pieces relate to what we believe is being possible. And I really push our advocates to help make sure our consumers recognize what those options could and should be, and then have them do their satisfaction work. That we find a way to have those who are using services be involved in the services, and that the organizations go about the business of doing its own self-assessment and using that information to create that plan for how we're going to get from point A to B to C to D. And within that plan, what kind of training needs are necessary, what types of developmental needs are necessary for those who are involved with the organization. That plan should include ways in which we do an ongoing engagement of communities. And I don't mean outreach to communities, I mean partnering with communities as being part of our goal. And that we have built in our way of doing our own continuous quality improvement so that we are always in the business of adapting and improving what it is and how we do it. And finally, that our plan includes elements that say, we know this is tough work. We know that we're scratching the surface if we're only doing training. We need to have a place where it is safe for folks to talk about what's really on their minds authentically and not get in trouble. So that there should be that refuge for sharing and learning. The other thing that we do, that's more of the how, is recognize that if we're building an infrastructure of an organization, that there are certain things that we need to make sure is addressed with a cultural lens. So whatever that book of business it is that you're doing, you know, the educational endeavor, what's the curriculum and who's the teaching and who are the students and those types of things. If you're doing mental health services around the nature of the intervention, the assessment tools, what we know about those and how we do the evaluation, what the medications issues are, what the formularies are, whatever that book of business is, that we're clear about the cultural lens that we're using to do that work. The human resource side says, well, yes, we want diversity. There are lots of reasons for diversity, and maybe we can talk about that during our discussion. But not only do we need diversity in those who are providing services, but everybody needs to have some training and development. So just because I'm black does not mean that I am skilled in working with all black folks. And that any interaction that we have is a cross-cultural interaction. Why? Because there's so many cultural components about who we are. And that we're always going to be engaged in something that's a cross-cultural interaction. So we need training. But we also need to value it enough in our organizations that we have expectations of the workforce around those matters. So is it in the job descriptions? Is it in personnel performance evaluations? When we're giving awards for Employee of the Month, do elements around cultural competence become part of the elements that we're using to do those assessments for awards and the special parking place or the dinner or the banner, whatever it is that we do for our staff? Do we include issues around cultural and linguistic competence in that bucket? The fiscal resources, where the money goes, we get complaints all the time around, we can't afford to do interpretation. We can't afford to do it. And I guess we can afford to turn on lights. I guess we can afford to have computers. If we value this work, we are going to be intentional around resourcing the work, and we allocate budget for the plans. I know in my office where we have the opportunity to do reviews of grant proposals, the director of our department, to our good, first thing that she'll go to is the budget first things you'll look for is there a budget line for interpretation translation services? Because if you're not asking to put it in there, then you're going to be the, oh my gosh, I can't afford it. We also want people to be financial citizens, that where they have the purchasing authority, that they're using that purchasing authority to benefit the community in which they're providing services. So whatever those vending opportunities are, to use them. And as we spoke earlier about the mechanisms to promote cultural engagement, I mean community engagement, and to kind of look at that as a way of identifying people who can be those cultural brokers as well. And if we're in a role in which we are subcontracting to others, that we do that work in a way that we are holding those who have those subcontractors as accountable for their cultural and linguistic competence as we're holding for ourselves. So these are some of the big picture elements that become the base for, the base for a lot of the work that we do. Now, the big thing here is that for most organizations, it means something in the organization needs to change. Something in the organization needs to change. And when it comes to cultural and linguistic competence, this middle bullet is the one that we operate with a lot. Resistance should be expected in different stages of multicultural organizational change because the topics of prejudice, discrimination, oppression, and power are controversial and emotionally charged. This is the environment that we are operating in. So in most situations, when we talk about change, there is a certain level of anxiety and a certain level of apprehension. There's a certain number of folks who just don't want to do it because they're comfortable in the way they're doing it, and they just balk at the notion of doing something different. But eventually they get there, except when it comes to issues around culture. That because of these factors, change in those dimensions, whether it's kind of moving from classroom-based instruction to distance instruction, or one of my other colleagues gives us a riot when she talks about her movement from her Selectric typewriter to a computer. Like, that was a huge shift for her. But anyway, there are some things that are easier for us to manage than others. And issues around race, culture, religion, immigration become those areas that are often very dicey for organizations to deal with and tackle. Now, we do know some things from the world that's emerging in implementation science, and they do talk about the importance of good innovations and effective implementation strategies. That enabling context becomes real big when we talk about culture, that then leads to socially significant outcomes. So we do want that to happen. So we are thinking through then, well, what is it that we as trainers and technical assistance providers can offer organizations that are struggling with this angst about change in areas of cultural and linguistic competence? And we do know that there are things that come from the implementation science, some things that come from organizational change theories, some things that come from leadership theories that we really do use and apply in this work. And I think it's really important for us to remember that when we're talking about organizations doing this, it's not that cultural competence is over there somewhere, but that we are talking about the fabric of the organization. And that if certain change theories work for moving different processes within organizations in neutral domains, that there's an element of that that is useful for us in this domain as well. So if we think about just kind of the whole notion about treatment, a lot of the language around mental health interventions in particular speaks to an intervention as if it's disembodied from anything else. So functional family therapy, cognitive behavioral therapy, patient-centered interactive therapy. All of these are wonderful, wonderful evidence-based treatments that are implemented through human beings. That's that P, people, who are cultural beings. And we bring our cultural self. I'm not talking about issues about bias or whatnot. I'm just saying we bring our cultural selves into the story. And we are using ourselves as active agents to offer this intervention within an organizational frame that also influences us. So organizations have their culture, organizations have their climate. So a lot of the work by Charles Glisson really talks about the impact of organizational changing, organizational culture and climate. So we have this little bucket over here of these interacting factors. And the people we're working with are not isolated either. Yes, we're doing play therapy with a child who has a mother. There was a dad somewhere in the picture, and we often, in certain communities, fail to invite dads to be part of the world, okay, regardless of class. There's a network out there, present or wished for, birthed or created, that's influencing what's happening with that person as they're interacting with us as people. And all of this is happening within the context of social determinants of health or illness. So, one, we have to recognize that all of this is part of the treatment. So as we're doing our work around moving toward cultural and linguistic competence, we need to think about each of these components and what is the place of culture with each of those. So what do we know about the interventions? What do we know how they were created, how they were normed? What do we know about their current impact on various populations? What do we actually know? We talk about the work on helping us as individuals do what we do in a way that is culturally and linguistically competent. We talk about the organizational environment. What's our knowledge of the network and how do we include them? What are the cultural norms about who should be included and what role they should play in the service interactions? And what are we doing in terms of the social determinants of health and mental health? I was delighted to see an article in the paper today about university hospitals and its volunteer and online program to help people with basic necessities, whether it's getting help with paying a bill or getting a piece of furniture for their babies or whatnot. It was like there's a social domain here that is influencing health behavior, and the doctors have the opportunity to write a prescription for social-related help. Wow. That's taking responsibility for building in our knowledge about social determinants in our intervention process. From the world of implementation science and for those of us who've been doing work with the system of care, we really look to the National Implementation Research Network for a lot of guidance and support. And they talk about these three elements, the training, the coaching, performance measurement, which is kind of near and dear and close to us when we think about implementation. But they also talk about the same areas that we were talking about with organizational cultural competence, that there is that organizational environment that has to be structured and developed in a way that helps promote the work that we're doing. And then there's that work that's at the more societal level that we still have an opportunity and obligation to act upon to the extent that we can. And for those of you particularly who've done any work around addictions or whatnot, the stages of change is one of those areas that has kind of emerged as also a way of thinking about organizational change. And I note Laura Mayeno, who's done a really interesting crosswalk of what it takes to do to be a multicultural organization using the stages of change as the crosswalk for the types of actions that can be taken during various stages. As a trainer, technical assistance provider, I am frequently confronted by the cultural competence committees that are frustrated because their agency is not doing A, B, C, or D in the community. They're at that action. That's where they want to be. And they're frustrated because the leadership, if we were to use this model, are still at the pre-contemplation stage. And so what we do then is say, okay, if that's where they are, then your action as a committee is really moving those who are in positions of authority and decision making from pre-contemplation to contemplation. So it may not be that your agency is going to be doing things in the community right away, but you're going to be spending your time as a committee working with the board, working with the executive director, working with program managers. That may be what you're going to be doing. And no matter that the executive director was responsible for your creation, what you need to be doing is really working with that executive director around how the executive director is going to lead the organization in doing this work. And the last piece is, again, an example of one of the leadership theories that we work with around adaptive leadership in particular. So Ron Heifetz and his work, the difference between adaptive and technical work. So if we're all in agreement that we need to facilitate language access, then the agency's task is really to identify the best vendors and to do the contracts and to set up the procedural things within the agency to offer those services. But if instead we're confronted with the scenario of, look, my grandparents, my great-grandparents, they came here from some other place, they learned English, I don't know why we have to be about this business of doing language access. Well, we have a different type of issue now. We have a very different type of issue. And so the work is more in that adaptive work. If it requires changes in people's values, attitudes, and or habits of behaviors, we're into adaptive work. That's that attitudinal space that we're talking about. A shift in the way organizations now think and breathe in their own cultural world has to shift before they're able to do those technical things well around, you know, getting the right contract and doing the training and so forth. There's another organization that I work with in which it was predominantly African-American providers working with a predominantly African-American patient population. Their demographics changed. They were then working with a mixture of African-American and Latino patients. And they were struggling. They were struggling because they had been used to being representing the oppressed, working with their oppressed. And it was strange for them to experience themselves as actually being in a place of privilege vis-a-vis those with whom they were working. That was a strange set for them, that actually they were in a better place in the larger society than many of the clients who were coming to them. And they had to work with that. That became part of their adaptive work of how then were they going to be culturally competent working with the Hispanic community. So just some examples of the kinds of issues that we face. Another type of the issues around implementation is that culture is a big word. It covers a lot of territory. And there is nothing simple about the nuances within it. And how are we going to be authentic within all of those nuances if we're talking about culturally competent practice? So most of our services and systems were based on framework of Western Europe and kind of carrying those values and norms. So there was that cultural competence for those who came from that heritage. And we only began to actually feel the rift when it became more clear that some of the populations that were not doing well were those who were more marginalized and had a different cultural frame. So culture is part of all of us, but all of us in different ways. There is that population of those who are historically and currently underrepresented. And then there's that aspect, the fact that we are all carriers of multiple cultures. So if we're talking about our cross-cultural effectiveness, so what aspect of your culture am I really touching or not? And within any group, there's a lot of diversity. So finally, that we're struggling with the fact that there are these wonderful movements, the family movement, consumer movement, you name it, we've got it. And we begin to silo those populations as if internally they're homogenous, because we're all families, aren't we? We're all representing those with disabilities, aren't we? And yet, no, yes and no, that the way that's experienced is going to be variable depending on the other elements of our cultural identities. So we work with that. We struggle with having to nuance that, which is one of the reasons we ask the organizations to go through this process of thinking through what is it that they mean in their organization that reflects cultural competence for them. Another piece of our implementation question is, how do we really work with these isms? How do we really work with that? At the personal level, at the organizational level, at the structural institutional level. And I just call out for you the terms of conscious and unconscious bias. And how many of you are familiar with unconscious bias? Okay, good, good. You know how you have what I call the buzz concepts? All right, so unconscious bias seems to be the new buzz concept. It's an important one, though, because it really hits probably most of us who are in this room. Because there is this one sense of around bias that we say, those are the folks, the white sheets, the cones, and the slits, and I'm not that. And so I give myself a pass because I'm not that. I'm not that old 50s era segregationist. I'm not that. So I'm okay. I'm okay. And we fail to recognize the way that we, good folks, well-intentioned folks, are actually behaving in ways that show bias. And that because we're not owning up to it, we actually create more confusion and more trouble than dealing with the folks who knew where their bias was and were very declarative about it. So for us good folks, we really need to tackle this issue around unconscious bias. And there are definitely ways of surfacing that. And the good news is that in the same way that it was out of the world of neuroscience that we have come to understand what unconscious bias is, how it emerges, the source, and whatnot, we are also beginning to have more information about the malleability of bias and strategies to address the unconscious bias. So there is hope for us. So we do need to think about the fact that these elements around intergenerational historical oppression are very active, that the intergenerational over time themes still play out today, that we are still dealing with the experiences in our communities that show the vestiges of different types of discrimination and institutional oppression to this day. And so our work has to be not only with our internal selves, but also at the systemic and structural levels. And in final point, and we can talk about more of that but later, that a couple things around evaluation, and these are just global things to be thinking about. We don't have good, solid, psychometrically analyzed, embedded tools in a lot of ways around things that relate to culture. Now, National Center has developed an assessment tool that we do like, that really has those wonderful psychometric properties, that we that was kind of that level of analysis was done with one of your sister organizations, I think it was in the medical center. So we're happy about that. It still needs a level of field testing, but we are happy about the work that's already done. But you're not going to find many. But you will find some tools to help and that kind of provide some baseline for starting to think through your processes. And so that happens. And so organizations do their internal work, and some organizations do their bring in people to do audits for them. And indeed, you'll see organizations who will be looking at issues around their processes. And as I mentioned before, you'll see organizations that look at satisfaction in a number of levels. And again, waiting for Toby. The uplifting of the work around disparities has really helped us in terms of the way we think about outcomes. And within the mental health world, we're looking at clinical outcomes, but we're also looking at functional outcomes. And now we're also looking at issues around disparities and the issues around achieving equity. And so from the perspective of the various tools, we see that National Center has developed a number of tools, which are kind of listed here just as examples of that early assessment of what's going on in your organization, program, or practice, or what you're doing yourself individually. And with the disparities, it's important to think about the shift from thinking of equal to equitable. And this is one of those slides I just love, because in the first one, we see that we've got the equal stands that the kids are standing on. But as you see, we don't have equal outcome. We don't have equal impact. But equity says, okay, so actually we're not going to be equal. We're not doing equal service. We're not doing everybody the same. We are very intentionally doing things differently for different populations to achieve an equitable outcome. So that becomes a different layer of our understanding and a different aspect of our measurement and analysis that we need to pursue. So, and actually, thank you. I think we are at the end of the formal presentation so that we can have time for discussion.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Viv, in your work, Dr. Jackson. In your work, have you seen or come across any literature that shows a relationship between increased cultural competence and prejudice or discrimination, whether actual or perceived?
Increased cultural competence and a shift in prejudicial...
Whether there's been any relationship, if you have an increased level of cultural competency in an organization, has there been any studies looking at whether there is then a actual perceived decrease in prejudicial treatment or perceived discrimination?
I would say I don't know the answer in terms of the studies. So what I'll be looking at, what I'll be referencing is what we have witnessed over time with organizations that we've worked with and what the patients, clients, families are telling us and what we're observing. And I would say that the more engaged the families and youth are from the cultural communities, that we are seeing a difference in the behavior of the organizations, and we are getting report of better functioning. So I think, you know, those of you who are interested in pursuing research, these are the kinds of studies that we really need to see. It also means those who are funding studies need to direct their attention to funding it, because this is one of those areas that is a struggle, that we talk about systemic issues. Part of the systemic issue is who's making decisions about funding of the research. And if they're not funding it, it ain't happening. Oh, excuse me, this is a professional. So that's part of the dilemma. But we are seeing that as people become more engaged, because what's happening is that the more you are moving in that journey of cultural competence, it means that the interactions that are taking place are much more authentic. And when there's that authenticity, there is the partnership, there is the engagement in the recovery work, there is the excitement and the joy around getting better. Then you've got a word of mouth thing going, in which people are saying, oh, come over here, because my son went there. You should see him in class now. He's getting better grades. I only get called by the principal's office once a month instead of twice a week. So we're seeing those kinds of changes occur where we are seeing organizations take it seriously and actually move.
Keep it in this row. Dr. Jackson, the slide, the Francesca slide was very powerful for me. And I wanted to ask you about some of the consulting that you do with organizations, and in particular staff, helping them to be able to talk with leadership about, you know, what they observe to be able to help move them along, because that's got to be very challenging.
Yes, and so they find allies within the organization to help give them access. It depends on the size of the organization, the structure of the organization. But let's say it's a relatively large organization. They seek out allies. And they do their research on who is it that people are listening to, and try to identify allies amongst that cadre of folks who their executive director is listening to, and engage that person into the work to help strategize, sometimes to be the voice, sometimes to be the person to offer the information. They also spend time in trying to understand, what is it that our agency is really dealing with? What is it that our executive director is struggling with? When we talk about cultural competence, we talk about understanding the culture of those whom we're serving. And so now we're saying, you need to spend some energy in understanding the culture of your leader, culture of the person who is in that role of authority. What is their world like? What are they struggling with? What are the questions that they are trying to answer? What are they trying to do to save the organization or to promote the organization? And frame the kinds of things that you think are important in ways that meet that need. And then the other piece that we talk about is the importance of people telling the story. So you want the data, you want the good relationships, you want the support on the goal and mission of the organization as a whole, but we also want people to tell the story of what it means to them, either in the negative or the positive, who are actually the actual recipients of services or members of the community. to be able to articulate that with those who are in those roles. And you need to allow yourself time to do that. None of this work happens overnight. And I was talking earlier today with a group of students, and that the that one of the organizations that I work with now started with a group of five or six people. And 4 or 5 years out, they're kind of doing conferences of 200, 300 people. But over time, they've worked with individual social service agencies to the point that now one of the directors is very upfront, does his thing to other directors around how he has shifted the way his agency operates and his continual journey in that. But it was slow, it was persistent, it was ongoing, and they made a difference. They absolutely did. The inside joke is that these questions are coming from members of my cohort.
Because we're so comfortable with you. I'm really struck by several themes in the, what you're describing, and it comes back to the authenticity that you're trying to cultivate in organizations. And in order to do that, it essentially requires moving off of sort of a cultural chauvinism to having some humility and some vulnerability that comes with that. And I guess I have two thoughts about that. One is that also chips away at the inherent power structure between the providing organization and the client base, which by definition for some people, it's, you know, if it weren't for your culture, you wouldn't be the client base. And that, you know, many organizations have managed to overcome that, but it continues to exist that I've seen. What I'm wondering about is, has there been any follow-up or research on the impact on the staff members, the organizational members, in terms of how they perceive their own work? And you sort of touched on that in terms of this director, and it, even continuing it, or considering it to be a continuing journey, is moving off of being an expert role. And so I'm wondering if anybody's kind of taken up that aspect of the research and seeing what's happened there.
I can't, again, I can't speak to where the research is. That we know that some of that is taking place, kind of where it actually lands, I'm not really sure. What we have observed is that there are some people for whom the shift in power relationships is so significant for them that they don't stay. As the organization is moving in that direction, that for them, the notion of being expert and being in control and being the one who presents the treatment plan rather than working collaboratively to create a treatment plan, that is so foreign for them that they leave. And then there are others who are the, you know, early adopters, and they go for it and they love it. They think of it as a breath of fresh air, and why didn't we do this earlier? And it can bring on the others with them. They feel a different sense of empowerment collegially, and the issues of power within the organization also shifts. So I was talking earlier about the issues around organizations that value diversity and diversity of thought. And just going in, the more horizontal an organization is in its structure, the less command and control in its structure, the more opportunity we've seen for changing in the dynamics. The more rigid, the more difficult it has been, but not necessarily impossible. It's just a kind of a different process that does take place. So, research questions, these are all incredibly important questions for study.
Do we have a last question from another row? Well, I am not in your cohort, but I was wondering how valuable is buy-in from community members or input from community members who may be key or critical pieces of the community but not part of the organization? And along with that, the second question is, how do you gain that if that is important?
Yeah. It is important. It is important. And it is not easy. So, I'm trying to, where was it? It was either Portland or Seattle, one of those cities. So one of our colleagues was working with the Department of Health, and that was part of the task. And it really was pounding the pavement. To actually, they were doing door-to-door work in asking questions about, if you are going to direct me to someone in your neighborhood that people turn to for help and guidance and support, who would that person be? And they began to collect that type of information, and names began to surface. And then those became the people that the department approached around providing support and assistance in terms of kind of identifying what the needs were of the neighborhood and being a bridge between the department and the communities. So that's a fairly massive undertaking. There are others who are very attentive to what is it that these neighborhoods and communities are doing? Where are they gathering, and gathering around what? So in many of the African American communities, especially when you're talking about young people, you know, you're going to be, who are the radio personalities? Who are the radio personalities? And being at those places and watching, observing, and talking in those gatherings when they're doing things to begin to identify who key people are. Sometimes it is the elected officials. Sometimes it is certainly certain of religious leaders. Not always. So it does matter to those whom you're serving. And of course, you can ask them, you know, who is it that's important to you? Who else do you think should be part of the work that we're doing, and hear what names pop up and begin to do that offering. An element of this is getting out of your structure. Getting out of your structure and being in the community and developing those relationships and allowing a snowball process to take place. And yes, it's important, because to know really what it is a community needs comes from their articulating that. And because we are experts in whatever, doesn't that mean that we are experts in what the needs are? And we cannot truly say what it is that we can offer until we actually hear what those needs are, and together come to some decisions about the framework and the format of that delivery. There, I forget the specifics, but my colleague in Massachusetts talks about working with members of the Vietnamese community in that area, and whatever this organization was doing for a variety of specific cultural groups, what they did was done on location. But for the Vietnamese, they were in a site within their community that they identified, because that's what was important to them. So it's, again, back to the issues around authenticity. If you're authentically offering services, yes, you need to hear from community. If you only leave it with those who come into your doors, you're only left with the people who felt safe and comfortable enough to come to your doors. You don't know about those who did not come to your doors. So you have to go outside of your doors to connect with them.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm going to stand here because I'm having a couple of mic issues, so this is probably the best place for me to hear everyone. So I promise I'm not really hiding. Well, maybe on the inside I am, but I'm not hiding. It's just to be sure that everyone can hear me. It's really great to be back here. I was really quite shocked to get Betsy's phone call to say, hey, come on home, share some information with us. So I am approaching this from a slightly different angle. I haven't had the pleasure of being exposed to all the information that Vivian shared with us today. So what I want to share with you today is basically what my reality was as I started working in the District of Columbia. I worked on two SAMHSA grants while I was there, working with the Department of Mental Health and with their substance abuse agency on several substance abuse, mental health, co-occurring disorders projects. And so I want to share with you the underlying cultural issues that showed themselves in the midst of the work that we were doing. So I'll spend some time, I'm not gonna dwell on my professional background. I feel like I know quite a few of you, and the rest of you, it'll just bore you. Suffice it to say that I've been very fortunate in order to spend all of my academic career here at Case Western Reserve, and specifically at MSAS, and so that's always been probably one of the blessings that I've had in this lifetime. I spent the past several years working as a program evaluator, and I kind of like slid into that. I thought I was going to just be a researcher on a project in GW, only to find out that, hey, guess what? You're an evaluator. And then I want to share some of the global, international perspectives and responses to the cultural issues within evaluation. And then for those of you who aren't very familiar with program evaluation, I want to give you a couple of useful resources that you can utilize in order to work with evaluators you might be hiring for projects or for your agency, or if you decide that you want to do some program evaluation yourselves. What's most important here, I think, is my employment history. I just want to share with you, I've had like a ton of research experience. I've started at the very lowest point. I was the runner for all the journal articles within the Poverty Center. I learned how to use all of the research tools, and we're talking about back in the dark ages when we still had the CD-ROMs that you had to put in order to do your lit searches. To being able to actually help with program management and training interviewers. During my doctoral program, I worked on the dual disorders research project that was funded here at the school. And out of that came my dissertation topic, looking at the inhibitors and facilitators of treatment for women with co-occurring disorders. So, a natural progression out of that was getting my job in Washington, D.C. at GW, working with these two organizations in co-occurring disorders. When I first got there, I was like, hey, they got this job just for me. So I want to share with you those experiences that I had working with this great group of people. Now, the American Evaluation Association, which is basically the organization, it's similar to NASW, for evaluators here in the U.S. They came out with a public statement in 2011 about cultural competency, and I'd like to share that with you. So they're saying that evaluators have power to make difference, not only directly to program stakeholders, but also indirectly to the general public. This is consistent with the guiding principle that obliges evaluators to consider the public interest and good in work they do. In a diverse and complex society, cultural competence is central to making a difference. So, what I've done here is I've taken the four aspects that AEA, or the American Evaluators Association, has outlined as the ideas that are most prevalent when you think about cultural competency. So acknowledging the complexity of cultural identity. First of all, when we typically hear cultural identity, we think of race, gender, socioeconomic status. Well, I'm here to tell you that on my first project, I got exposed to that entirely new culture that is DC government. Now, prior to this experience, I had never worked directly with government agencies. I was never that front person. So in several aspects, this was totally alien and new to me. So I was a good little researcher. I thought I prepped myself. I read all the documentation about who would be working on the project, who would be sitting at the table with me, who planned the project. Oh, by the way, I came in on like at 2.5 years into the project. So all of this work had already been done, and I was the new kid on the block. And I was replacing someone that they were very, very fond of. So my first day, first meeting, I walk into the room with my supervisor, and the first thing everyone says is, oh, are you the new Frank? I was like, Frank? Who's Frank? Frank was the person I was replacing. And so they already had their backs up because they had built this incredible connection, this incredible team, where everyone knew everyone, they knew what the expectations were, and here's this stranger coming in, and oh, by the way, did we tell you she's a doctor, and so she knows more than Frank, and so she's supposed to be doing more than Frank? Yeah, that didn't go over so great. And so I spent the first several months just trying to learn how I would fit into that organization and showing them how I could be useful to them and validating the culture that they had already created and how I could assist them in the project and the goals that we all had in common. So that's not something they teach you in the books. One of the things that whole incident, and I have to apologize, I'm not the best at graphics. So trying to get ideas across are fairly elementary, so. But I think you get the gist of it. So there was a power play at place when I walked into that room, you know. People already had their assumptions about who I was, what I was bringing, what I was expecting of them, what they were expecting of me. And I was in a place where I had very little power coming in. You know, they had their own private little history. They had their own language. Oh, let me tell you about the language in DC. I was telling people earlier, it's a total alphabet soup. And so here I am in meetings and they're rambling off CFSA and blah, 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 and DMH. And I was like, wait, slow down. Who are we talking about now? What are we talking about? And getting used to that culture and spending my nights studying the alphabet, you know, was very, very important to, you know, evening the playing field for me. But also, there were power dynamics in place between the agencies at the table. It was a great experience working on this because these agencies were willing to partner together, but they didn't have the same authority or power within district government in order to affect change. One agency was autonomous. They stood on their own, and they were their own entity, while another agency actually fits under the umbrella of a larger agency. So there was already a disparity there. In addition, they didn't have the same number of staff represented within the team. So, and mostly that was because of, you know, staffing resources. So making sure that both organizations were represented equally, making sure that both organizations were listening to each other in order to, you know, get a common ground so we could actually work on what the consumers need was a really huge issue for us. And it always kept coming back up because, you know, somebody would go fishing in that lake of history and be like, but remember when so-and-so took all of our money and didn't share and the money was never allocated appropriately. We don't want that happening again. So this is the culture in which we've been working in. And these are the things that we had to overcome and work through and build our teamwork through. So one of the issues that that AEA wants you to think about is recognizing and eliminating bias in social relationships. Well, on one of the projects we were working on, it was to develop an adolescent substance abuse treatment service delivery system within the district. And part of that was training and educating the potential providers in the assessment tools that they wanted to use universally throughout the district so that they were on an even keel in terms of assessment and analysis so that if an individual left one agency and went to another, they would have the same information and treatment plans could be taken up in the same place. Well, we did a ton of research. We had experts in child development. We had experts in substance abuse, mental health. We had this great team. We did all this planning. We did all this research. We checked the norms and the validity of all the tools we were using. That wasn't enough. One of the tools that we used was an assessment tool. And had been used in the district in some way, shape, or form previously as a screening tool. There's a much shorter version of it that was used as a screening tool in some of the agencies. When we identified the individuals who were going to be working with us in order to be trained on these screening tools, we were very conscious of picking like the cream of the crop. So these were people who were licensed clinicians. They had worked extensively in their fields, be it mental health or substance abuse. So these were people with a lot of clinical experience. And they had worked with lots of screening and assessment tools and had done all the treatment plans. So these are people with experience. So we were like, oh, this will be no problem for them to pick up this new tool. You know, it's a tool that's been around. It had not previously had success in the district. Having people qualified in order to use it. But we figured we could work through that, you know, because we've got this stellar team and we've got these people who are committed to using this instrument. So the initial training for it was 3.5 days, intensive days, long days of interactive training on the assessment tool, followed by extensive technical assistance sessions with each site with the trainers of the instrument. And then they were required to actually do their quality assurance measures, which required them to record themselves using the assessment tool with a client. And they had to submit those tapes to be scored appropriately. Now we know that the organization who scored this, we know that they did their due diligence, you know, they trained their raters and whatnot. But we found that our people were not passing the quality assurance piece. Or they would pass sections of it, but they wouldn't pass everything. And you had to score, I think it was at least 90% on each of the sections before you were certified on the measure. So they would come back and they would try it again and do it again. And eventually on the second try, I think we got 3 people through. We started with 16 people. 3 people actually finished their certification on that second go round. But that still left the other 13 standing there, frustrated, having to do the qualifying again. So I decided to look at the information that was coming back, look at who had passed the qualifying section and who was still struggling with it. And what I found was the people who were still struggling were actually individuals who were from African and Caribbean nations, people who have accents, people who have different intonation in their voice. Now, you have to understand, DC is really like a cultural mixing pot. I mean, you have some of everything, which is one of the great things about living there. So my bias was that I never even considered that someone having an accent would be an issue for them passing this qualifying piece. But here's the thing, no one else considered it either. So we had to go back to the trainers. And actually, let me back up. One of the things that happened when they sent the training team to us, they sent us a training team that looked nothing like the people who were being trained, who hadn't had a training experience or worked in environments that were similar to the agencies that our folks were representing. So they sent us three European American women who were from the suburbs of Massachusetts and Connecticut. And most of our folks were working in the inner city of DC, working with, I mean, it's a public health system, so working with folks who have had varied life experiences that are not necessarily the easiest. So coming up with folks with lots of challenges. So they couldn't relate to what our folks were going to be dealing with. So short attention spans, not wanting to sit there for 2.5 hours to do this instrument, you know, making allowances for those things. But then adding on to that, the fact that they couldn't deal with the accents. Sometimes the accents made it sound like the trainers were being aggressive or they were being a terse with the client. Or they were being too timid, or they were reading into it. Because we all know the best way to do any of these instruments is to be as neutral as possible and give it the same way each time we do it. So this was a huge issue. So we brought this to the attention of the company that developed the instrument, and we did some technical assistance around it, working with their trainers, as well as with our staff. And eventually we got everybody through. I mean, it was hard. It was really, really hard. But we were able to get that cohort through, and they passed the certification. Well, now we were armed with all this information so that when we did the second cohort of training for this instrument, the company had totally changed their mindset. They sent us trainers who had experienced different populations, worked with different populations in different settings, like urban, depressed areas, you know, highly populated. So we had a nice mix of working with immigrant populations. They sent us a nice mix of trainers. And then they threaded through the entire training all of the cultural components and things that might be of issue for someone administering the assessment tool during that training. So previously they made it, oh, by the way, you might have to deal with this. But it became a more prevalent portion of their entire training so that folks were aware of how to work around it and work with it. Also out of that, they decided to create a cultural competency committee so that they could actually look at their tool and make sure that it was sensitive to the diversity of the folks it would be used on, all of the consumers who would have to experience this. So I lost track of that after I left the project, after the project ended. But they were very, very committed to changing their mindset within their organization and developing a tool that would be more accessible to all of the persons who might have to experience that. So despite all of our best planning, implementing what we thought was going to be stellar program, you know, we still come up with these biases that we just never, who could have anticipated that one? I mean, really. So just to say, you know, beware. Don't beat yourself up, but figure out how to work through those processes. And this really just adds on to it. You know, our folks were seen as deficit because they couldn't pass. By the way, the second cohort, most people were qualified on the first or the second round. So it was much, much quicker process for them to get through that training. And they weren't as frustrated by the entire process. And as a side note, you know, that entire group, the first cohort and the second cohort, were actually some of the first folks to pass that and be certified within the district. So it was really quite nice. Continued self-assessments. We've all had these days, you know. We look in the mirror and I can't even tell you how many times I would love to be buying what that lady's buying. Yeah. But more often, it's more like the gentleman. It's like you look in the mirror, it's like, ooh, what happened? So it's not just that we need to be assessing ourselves, but we need to be also assessing our organizations, our expectations of how are we really doing everything that we can in order to provide the best services that we can for our consumers and even our clients as the evaluator. Are we doing the best that we can? And sometimes that we're not going to always like what we see in the mirror. So then we have to work on how are we going to change that? How are we going to work through that? What can we do to change that process? So as you can see, that my evaluation experience has been interesting. And I really mean that in the best possible way, because I don't, despite all of the learning, all of the experience I've had, I don't think that anything could have possibly prepared me for the underlying cultural issues that were going to hit me as soon as I walked in. So, if you're out in the field, just be prepared for anything. So I'd like to talk to you a little bit about what is happening in terms of evaluation and culture on a global level. Now, the AEA has reported on their website that 18% of their membership are made up of international folks from more than 60 countries. And 20% of their members live and or work outside of the United States. Now, that's big. AEA has their annual conference each year. They offer international travel scholarships in order to help folks come to the programs. But often, you know, there's not enough scholarship money to go around. In recent years, they've been doing simulcasts of some of the keynote addresses so that people who can't afford to attend can at least view what's happening at the conference so they can have some kind of interaction. And you can also, they also make it so that you could purchase sessions that you might be interested in order to accommodate folks who can't leave their site in Thailand or Vietnam or wherever they might be. I worked for the evaluation, the TEI, the Evaluation Institute, for many years, and they provided professional development training for individuals who are interested in evaluation research. And what we noticed, especially in the past several years, is that we were having more and more inquiries for us to do actually international programs. Now, anyone who actually puts on training programs know that it's really quite difficult and challenging, even if you are a mobile program, to pick up that program and take it overseas. So there was never an opportunity to actually do that. But we tried to make it accessible to as many international folks as possible. But we had several challenges in doing that because there were groups of individuals who just were not going to be let into the country. We had lots of individuals who were coming from Pakistan, Afghanistan, you know, areas where they really want the research, where they really want the training, where they're doing a lot of developmental evaluation work, where they need those resources. They desire this training, but because of the state of affairs, they're not going to be allowed in on a visitor visa in order to participate in the trainings. So the organization is looking at different ways in which they can provide services to those groups. Now, one of the organizations that has managed to offer training to a more international crowd is the International Program for Development Evaluation Training Program, also known as IPDET. And they are in Ottawa, Canada. And they provide, once a year, they provide a four-week training course in developmental evaluation work. And their whole purpose is to get those general skills, core skills, and values into the hands of people who are doing international work so that they can go back and build on that knowledge and share that knowledge with their colleagues and build evaluation capacity in their communities. So far, they've had about 161 countries represented over the past 15 years. I think that speaks volumes as to the need and the desire for having this training available throughout the global community. One of the big initiatives that has been going on in the area this past year was the Year of Evaluation. This has been several years in the making. I believe it was 2013. They decided to, and it was at a conference in Brazil, I believe. They decided that in order to move evaluation forward and to build capacity on a global level, they needed to come up with some strategies in order to expand that knowledge. And so making the Year of Evaluation 2015, their whole concept was increasing the use of evaluation on a national, international, local, regional level. And each of the regions decided to plan events. And there's an entire laundry list. I think there were at least 100 events that happened over the year where folks hosted events, invited in politicians and government agencies to help them understand what evaluation means, how it can be used in making decisions that is evidence-based, and understanding the great tool that it could be for them in the future. One of the components buried deep down in the documentation has been encouraging women to participate in evaluation. Now, that might seem a little weird for us sitting here in the United States, but in several cultures, women are not necessarily considered to be or should be taught this information. And so it has been a challenge in some communities, in some cultures, in order to have women sit at the table and have a voice and express their knowledge and intelligence about policy issues in their area. It's really, really challenging. But we've had women come through the Evaluators Institute who have excelled and they've gone back to their agencies and they've become the directors and they've moved on to other agencies where they can excel and flourish and share the knowledge that they've gained with other women who are interested in evaluation. So now I'd like to talk to you about a few resources that are available, because I forgot to ask, but how many of you are actively evaluating or consider yourselves program evaluators? Hey, Rob. So I apologize for boring you, because you all know all this. So I wanted to share resources with the rest of you that would help you, you know, even if you decide, I want to just take a little look, or what do I need to think about in terms of hiring an evaluator? What things should I be looking for when I work with an evaluator? And just understanding the language, that sort of thing. So there's some really great resources out there that'll help you. And one of my favorites, I feel like I'm on it almost every day, is the AEA website. This has like so much information that is useful to you. Not only can you join on their website, but they have a listing of professional evaluators who are working in the field, who are willing to take on clients. And so it's this wonderful resource. It's like the yellow pages of evaluators. It also gives employment opportunities for folks who are looking for jobs. And it gives the local affiliates that are in your area. So if you're looking for someone a bit closer to home, or if you want to know what the evaluators are doing in your area, then you can look up the affiliates there. They also list on their website training and professional development opportunities that are available. About the annual meeting that happens once a year, usually in the fall. And they also do these great summer institutes. They're only about a week long, and they partner with the CDC in order to provide these trainings. And they open them up to everyone. And they give you little short snapshots about a topic. They're usually about half a day, some of them are a full day, where you can sit and be exposed to evaluation concepts. And they also have great coffee breaks, so they're only trainings that are about 15 to 20 minutes long to introduce you to topics. And they do more advanced webinars. And some of these will take 2 to 4 weeks in order to finish. So, I mean, they have quite a few things. Anyone who's looking for yet more education, they also have university programs that are doing degree programs and evaluation, and they have their listservs. So if you have any questions that you need answer, you know, folks are really responsive on the listserv. Better evaluation. Now, this is a newer website that's available, and this is brought to us from the folks who do research out of Australia. And what's great about the Better Evaluation website is they have toolkits, they have evaluation models, and they've collected this information from a global cadre of their colleagues. So other professionals from around the world have contributed to this website. So it's a great place in order to find information and get a broader base of information. I see lots of folks writing email address, writing websites, so I'll hold off.
Toby, tell people, this will be posted on the NSAS website.
It will be on the website, so you'll have an opportunity to check out the resources that are provided. And there, I need to tell you that there are a ton of resources, but I picked a few of my favorites. So that doesn't mean the others are bad. It's just these are my go-to sites. The Evaluation Center at Western Michigan University. They have a page of checklists. They have checklists of things I never even thought about. But it's a great resource. You can use these checklists free of charge for any of your programming. You can print it off. As long as you're not using it for commercial reasons, it's a free resource to anybody in the community. And you have to sign a little agreement saying you won't try and sell their information. But other than that, it's free and it's useful. And these are some of the topics that they cover. meta-evaluation. I don't know how many of us are going to be doing that. But in you know, you never know. It could happen. You might have several evaluations sitting on your bookcase that you need to think about. How are you going to handle those, and how are you going to compare across all of those different evaluations? The Eastern Evaluation Research Society, they are actually considered a local affiliate of AEA. But basically what they, I put them on the website because they provide an annual conference that's only about 2 or 3 days long. And they take a topic for that year and they invite in several keynote speakers and spend those days talking about that topic intensively. And one of the things that happens is the Eleanor Klimsky Forum of Evaluation in Theory and Practice. And that is a wonderful, wonderful place in order to hear from thought leaders in the world of evaluation. And all of those keynote addresses are actually on their YouTube page. So you can access those at any time. And I don't know how many places you can actually do that. And they're really informative and entertaining as well. And the Evaluators Institute. You know, I couldn't go anywhere without talking about the Evaluators Institute. I worked with the Evaluators Institute for about 5 of the 8 years I was at the university. And they provide a lot of professional development. There aren't very many organizations like this that I'm aware of. And one of the things that they do is they provide certificate programs. Now, certification has not become mandatory in the United States. Canada has actually moved to a certification process, and it is mandatory that you're certified in order to work as an evaluator. AEA hasn't moved that way. There have been talks about it. I don't know how soon that'll happen, but I can tell you that the certificates have been used in order to promote folks, to get jobs, to land clients, you know, on the consulting front. So they're very useful. Most of the certificates take about 30 program days for you to complete a certificate. So that doesn't mean 30 straight days. It usually takes multiple programs, at least a year worth of programming in order to get a certificate. But it's very doable. It's very useful information. They're interactive programming. And that's the end of my TEI commercial. Oh, they are now at Claremont University. So they've moved out to the West Coast, but they still offer their programming in Washington, D.C. As a matter of fact, their July program will be in Washington. The Center for Disease Control, how often do you think about going to one of the government agencies to think about finding your evaluation information? But they have really great resources there for evaluators. So, and the World Bank. The World Bank has tons of reports online. They have resources in terms of how-to sessions and slide presentations. Especially if you're into developmental evaluation, they're an excellent resource. And that's what I have for you. Are there any questions? Oh, whew, that was easy.
I'll go. Thank you, Toby. I guess I'm thinking about the situation where, because we think about cultural competence in regard to the program.
Yes.
And then cultural competence in regard to the evaluation of the program.
Yes.
And I've certainly, I would say, as an evaluator, sometimes there's a reluctance to specifically look at that as a dimension of program practice. So it might be lumped in with the quality of the program. Are we assessing that as part of the evaluation?
Exactly.
But I've certainly had experiences where at some point as the evaluator, you realize the program is culturally incompetent.
Yes.
And that as a result of that, in your partnership with them to design the evaluation itself is flawed in that same way. So this is not a good place to be in. If you're trying to assess the effectiveness of the program, and you realize the measures, the methods you've adopted are now out of touch with the reality of the lived experiences of the participants in the program. I just wonder if you would have any thoughts along that line of, you can have the perfect culturally competent program and evaluation that's out of step, but I'm thinking more about where you partner with the program and that leads you to adopt an evaluation approach that's also maybe not as dialed in as where it needs to be.
And I really think that it's part of the assessment process, and that's probably a continuing process that's going on throughout the process, throughout the evaluation that you're doing. I have to say, I don't think it's one of the first things we think of as evaluators, despite the fact that it's been brought to our attention and AEA has made this declaration. I don't know that we are very good at always addressing that as we're planning our evaluations, or even bringing that to the table as we start our meetings and think about, you know, what it is that our client wants us to be looking at in terms of that program. I mean, I think we look at it in a more, I hate to call it superficial, but very like surface level when we think about the basic demographics, you know. We think about, you know, is the language we're using in our instrumentation, is that appropriate for the consumers that we're working with, you know, the literacy level, that sort of thing. But I don't think that we think any deeper about it purposefully when we're doing that work. And that's needed so that the evaluations that we create can actually be useful to the communities. So it's something that I think has to be built into our thought process. It has to become more automatic in everything we do. Like, that's just one more thing that we need to consciously add to our evaluations and as we plan those.
It seems to play itself out.
Wait to the mic.
It seems to play itself out in the standard recruitment, engagement, retention. Those seem to be the places where you quickly see that something's not working, and a lot of times it relates back to cultural synchronicity with the population that's being tried to connect with. That's all.
Okay, thank you so much, Dr. Morton.
Thank you.
I'd like to thank both Dr. Morton as well as Dr. Jackson. It's so wonderful and such a rich experience for us to be here with you as you share this wealth of information that you have. Thank you for being here. It's wonderful to have you back home with us here at your school. And I would just like to introduce Dean Gilmore, who would like to just say a word.
Well, and I too want to thank Dr. Jackson and Dr. Morton for being here. It's great seeing you back here, seeing your accomplishments in the time since you've left the university. What a great session that we've had today. And it's good to know that the information is going to be on the website because it's loaded with lots of things we want to do. Actually, during the break, I actually went online and I pulled off the image that you had on equality versus equity, so that, and I've got it on my phone now because I want to start using that in my own presentations. So I really thank you for sharing that. These two graduates are an example of the high-quality individuals who come out of the Mandel School, both from our master's programs and also from our PhD program. It's one reason why this week in U.S. News and World Report, we were ranked number 9 once again among all social work schools. So we're very proud of that, and of course the faculty are very proud, but we know that the reason it happens is because of the work that's done by our alumni. So thank you all who are here. We have many alumni who are here and friends of the school and then soon to be alumni or aspiring alumni in the group. But thank you for all that you do, including this great work that's represented by Dr. Jackson and Dr. Martin today. And now we get to take a break and have a really nice reception outside where we can continue with the conversations. Thank you.